Harper Audio presents Framed by Frank Cottrell Boyce. Read by Jason Hughes. Copyright 2006 by Frank Cottrell Boyce. Production copyright 2006 by Pan Macmillan Publishers Limited. Published by HarperCollins Publishers.
You've probably never heard of Vincenzo Perugia, but we know all about him. He was a famous art thief, and we used to be in the same line of work. My sister, Minnie, even had a picture of him on her bedroom wall. She reckons that when Vincenzo stole the Mona Lisa from the Louvre Museum in Paris on 21st of August 1911, that was the most immensely perfect crime ever. The Mona Lisa was the world's most famous painting, but Vincenzo did such a neat job no one even noticed it was missing for 2 days. Then they did notice, and everything went mental. Everyone went to the Louvre to look at the empty space where the painting had been. They queued up to look at an empty space. Even Vincenzo Perugia queued up. And when they got to the front of the queue, they all looked at that empty space and thought about what used to be there. I can understand that. Sometimes something vanishes, and afterwards you can't stop looking at the place where it used to be. And all this time Vincenzo had it in his little room. The Mona Lisa was in a trunk next to the bed. Sometimes he took the painting out and played it funny songs on his mandolin. He didn't try to sell it. He didn't steal any other paintings. He didn't want to be famous or rich. He just wanted the Mona Lisa. And that's where he went right. That's why it was the perfect crime, because he didn't want anything else. And that's probably where we went wrong. We wanted something. Snowdonia Oasis Auto Marvel Manod. 11th of February. Cars today. Blue Ford Fiesta. Miss Stannard. Twix. Scania 118 Low Loader. Wrexham Recovery. Weather. Rain. Note. Oil is different from antifreeze. My dad, right? Ask anyone this. They'll all say the same. My dad can fix anything. Toyota. Hyundai, Ford, even nice Tom's mam's Diddy Daihatsu Copen, top speed 106 mph, which is about the size of a marshmallow, so you need tweezers to fix it. And it's not just cars. Like the time when we were at Prestatyn and Minnie wanted to swim, but I wouldn't get in the water because it was too cold. She kept saying, "Come in, it's fine once you're in." And I kept saying, "No." Dad got up, went to the caravan and came back with a kettle of boiling water. He poured the water in the sea and said, "Dylan, come and test it. Tell me if it's all right or does it need a bit more?" I said, "No, that's fine now, thanks, Da." "Sure now? Sure now? Not too hot then?" "No, just right." "Give me a shout. If it gets cold again, I can always boil up some more." Then Minnie splashed me and I splashed her and we stayed in the water till the sun went down. He fixed the sea for us. Now that is a thing to be admired. My big sister, Marie, never came in the water even after Dad fixed it. She said, "Have you any idea what seawater can do to your hair?" And later on, when we were playing Monopoly in the caravan, she said, "Did you really think that one kettle of water could warm up the entire Irish Sea?" I said, "Not the whole sea. Obviously, just the bit we were swimming in." "Yeah, like that would really work," said Minnie. "Let me explain the physics." "Minnie," said Mam, "Euston Road, three houses, £270, please." Typical of Mam, by the way, cleverly changing the subject like that. "Obviously, I know now that the kettle didn't warm up the sea, but that's not the point. I got into the water, that's the point. Dad looked at that situation and he thought, I can't do anything about the physics, but I can do something about Dylan. So he did. He's keen for us all to learn how to fix things too. That's how I came to be helping him with the oil change on Miss Stannard's Blue Fiesta, top speed 110 mph. I don't know how I came to make the mix-up about the oil. Dad said it would probably be best if I didn't go near the workshop again, or near a car again, really. He was quite calm about it. He said it was the kind of thing that could happen to anyone. Anyone who didn't know the difference between motor oil and antifreeze, that is. After that, Mam said I could take over the petrol log. That's the massive red book next to the till where we write down all the petrol sales so we can track supply and demand. The book is red with gold patterns on the front. It looks like a Bible. Mam got it in a car boot sale, car boot crazy at the Dynamo Blaenau Football Club ground, for 50 pence. It's got over 1,000 pages. We only use about a page a week, so it should last us 20 years. Bargain. No disrespect to Mam, obviously, but she was probably too busy with a new baby to make the most of that job. She just wrote stuff like 10:20 a.m, 4 gallons unleaded, whereas I put down all the detail, the make, the year, name of the driver, anything. I'd stay on the forecourt from home time till tea time. Sometimes nice Tom would come and sit with me, and if he said something like, "Mr. Morgan's offside back tyre is baldy," I'd put that down too. When Dad saw it, he said, "Dylan, you have made a 50 pence petrol log into a database. That is something to be admired." A database is very useful. For instance, when Dad read, "Mr. Morgan, offside back tyre baldy," he sourced a new tyre and offered it to Mr. Morgan. So a job that would have gone to acres of tyres in Harlech came to us instead. It saved Mr. Morgan time and it made us money. That's market research, and I did it. "And that," says Dad, "is how the Hughes family operates. Everyone has his job to do and everyone does it well. The Hughes family is an unbeatable team. We are the Brazil of Snowdonia." And the team sheet is Dad, captain, Mam, team manager and acquisitions at car boot sales, me, market research, Marie, she's very pretty, so I suppose you'd say presentation, and Minnie, well, general brains, really. Oh, and the baby. His name is Max, and he doesn't do much at the moment, but in 7 years' time, he will be able to play football. Because I put so much detail in the petrol log, I only have to look at it now, and I can remember anything about that day. For instance, in this entry for 11th of February, I remember Miss Stannard buying that Twix because she's my teacher, and I thought, ooh, Miss Stannard eats Twix. And I remember that the blue Fiesta is hers because it's the car that the mix-up happened to. And the Scania 118 low loader is this immense 8-wheel truck with a beaver tailgate, lifting tackle and an intercooler engine. It came to take Miss Stannard's car away. Like I said, Dad can fix nearly anything. Miss Stannard's Fiesta is the exception that proves the rule. 15th of February. Cars today. Blue Barracuda mountain bike. Man in a balaclava, parked by the Altagaz. Green Daihatsu Copen, Mrs. Egerton, parked right up against the car vac, didn't buy petrol. Tiny 659cc engine, not a big drinker. Weather, raining. Note, balaclavas encourage crime. This one is the petrol log for the day of the robbery. The robbery was the first time any of us had seen a criminal in action up close, so it was probably a major influence on our later work. A man came into the garage with a balaclava over his face and a big sledgehammer and shouted at Dad to empty the till. Dad knew who it was right away. It was Daft Tom. He knew because Tom's mam had knitted me a very similar balaclava for my birthday. Also, Tom had customised the eye holes himself, and the wool was starting to unravel around the nasal area so you could nearly recognise him. Anyway, Dad pretended to empty the safe. "It's a time lock, see?" he said. "So it'll take a couple of minutes. You stay calm and help yourself to whatever you like from the sweet rack."
"Just move it, Mr. Hughes."
That was another bit of a clue, the robber calling Dad Mr. Hughes. The final clue, by the way, was the big blue mountain bike, which was the only big blue mountain bike in town and which everyone remembers Daft Tom winning in the Christmas lights raffle. He was also wearing a Ninja Turtle cycling helmet, and everyone knows that Daft Tom is obsessed with the turtles, which is unusual in a grown man. Daft Tom got into the turtles when they first came out, same as everyone else. But when everyone else grew out of them, he carried on liking them. He was always buying turtles, T-shirts, videos, collector's cards, the original turtle lair with extra sewage piping, ninja chopping pogo copters, sewer sledges, shell subs with torpedoes. He had a boxed set of superposable models of Donatello, Raphael, Leonardo and Michelangelo with 67 points of articulation each and even a full-size strap-on turtle shell. Anyway, back to the robbery. Obviously, we haven't actually got a safe. When Dad said he was opening the safe, he was actually texting Daft Tom's mam, and she came round in a little copen. Daft Tom didn't hear or see the car pull up because the engine is so small, you can only hear it if you're a bat or a shrew or something. So when she walked in, he nearly choked from shock. And when she walloped him across the back of his legs with her unnecessary crook lock, well, he shouted, "What the shell?" Another giveaway. And then, well, he just keeled over, really. Daft Tom's mam wanted to report him to the police, but Dad was dead against it. "The town of Manod," he said, "has the lowest crime rate in the United Kingdom. We're not going to spoil that for one mistake." And he offered him a job. "You come and work in the garage for a few weeks and we'll say no more about it. I can't pay you, mind?" His mother was upset. She said, "We have no way of knowing what our deeds will lead to. Look at me. I was just trying to keep my son's ears warm, like a good mother. And where did that lead? If I had not knitted him a balaclava, he might never have been seduced into criminality." The good thing about Daft Tom was that he could work the photocopier, which no one else could because when Mam bought it, Snowdonia Mountain Rescue Charity Shop, £20, it didn't have a manual. Daft Tom crouched in front of it and kept pressing buttons until he had it all worked out. By the end of the week, the Snowdonia Oasis Auto Marvel had become the Snowdonia Oasis Auto Marvel and Copier Centre. And Daft Tom had become Nice Tom, except to his mam. So there's another thing that Dad fixed. He fixed Daft Tom. That was the end of his life of crime. Which is funny when you think about it, because it was probably the start of ours. 12th of March. Cars today. Rover 3500 V8, the Mrs. Selwood. Weather, rain. Note, Manod Wednesdays. It's true that we do have quiet days at the Snowdonia Oasis. There are three reasons for this. Reason one, no one knows where Manod is. There's so much to see and do in Manod, it should have a massive sign like the ones for London or Blackpool. Sadly, there's no sign at all, not even on the A496, close to which the town is conveniently situated. There used to be a sign on the grass verge just after the sign for Diggermania. That's a theme park in Harlech where you ride around on diggers. But an egg van backed into it and knocked it over and no one's ever fixed it. The council says a new sign is not a funding priority. Dad gets cross about this about once a week. He says that the lack of a sign robs him of potential passing trade. Reason two. To be honest, though, we wouldn't get passing trade because you can't pass our garage. The Bliner Road, the B5565, ends just behind the car vac. The Snowdonia Oasis Auto Marvel is literally the end of the road. Unless you open the gate and then there's the mountain road, but that's not really a road, just a track they used to use to bring down the slate from the quarry at the top. The gate is there to stop Mr. Morgan's sheep wandering down off the mountain and onto the high street. It's part of my job to keep the gate shut or, if it is left open, chase the sheep back. If the sheep don't want to be chased, I open a packet of quavers. Sheep will follow you anywhere if you're carrying an open packet of quavers. Try it. Mr. Morgan is a customer, so sheep chasing is customer relations. Reason three, the Mrs. Selwood. The Mrs. Selwood live on a farm halfway up Manod Mountain. Miss Elsa can drive, but she can't see. Miss Edna can see, but she can't drive. So what they do is, every Wednesday, Miss Elsa drives and Miss Edna steers. It's not so risky on the mountain road because no one lives up there, apart from them and Mr. Morgan's sheep. But when they hit the high street, they are a menace to society. Some car names are annoyingly random. The Fiat Cappuccino, for instance, is not really a cup of coffee. The beetle is not an insect, and the rover's not a dog.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.